David Hume was born into a family of poor landed gentry in Edinburgh in 1711. One of Hume's major concerns was the relationship between cause and effect, causality. It was, and still is, important not only to Hume, but to philosophy generally, because without an understanding of it, the universe consists of random, unconnected events. Understanding causality not only means making sense of the world we live in, but our place in it as well, and our experiences. Hume started with attempts to prove the existence of God and the self. Hume claimed we must have observational evidence in experience of God and the self. But we have no direct experience of God. We cannot hear, see, touch, or experience God in any tangible way. Feeling that God must somehow exist is not enough.
Hume is a skeptic as far as religion is concerned, because the mind operates through custom, there is this kind of cement through habit and association. It can only work on material that has been received through the senses. Because there is no impression of God or of anything beyond this world, we can't appropriately extend the abstract ideas that we think we have, but are just these bundles, to the realm of the religious. So there's an attack on religion, which is very strong. And really, one of the things that he argues is that all priests are necessarily hypocrites, because they have to disguise to themselves their unbelief. And he doesn't go as far as to deny that God exists, but through the mouth of various characters, he undermines belief in a first cause, in God as a substance, in the soul as a unity, and in immortality of the soul.
Hume concludes that in order for us to have any knowledge of a supreme being is to witness an action that transgresses the laws of nature, as it is only through the world that God, as an infinite being, can express his nature and make himself felt. So God makes his presence known through miracles. Hume claimed that, like God and the self, we cannot observe causal connection.
For Hume, causality is just a succession of ideas, a contiguity of ideas, which are then linked together by the mind. And you can't actually find the necessity in nature. It's something that the mind adds in on top.
This holds true even with things that seem certain, like night following day. Day is not the cause of night. Night is brought on by the rotation of the earth on its axis as it travels around the sun. We cannot observe this rotation, so how can we be completely sure that night will follow day? Can we get beyond conjunction of events to actually observing their causes? Can we distinguish between events that are causally connected to those that are not? If we cannot, how can we make any general statements about the world? Where does this leave science?
He's not attacking science. As I said, he thinks of himself as a Newton of the mind. It's just that science and the connections in science have to be explained psychologically instead of in terms of logical and philosophical relations.
Hume had an answer to this seemingly bleak scenario. Although he advises we should hold our opinions with a healthy dose of skepticism, Hume was realistic about what drives human beings and the role played by the emotions. If we did try to live our lives querying everything we saw and stubbornly refusing to go about our daily lives because we do not know anything for certain, we would all curl up and die. It is better to be proved wrong sometimes in our assumptions than to abstain from doing anything at all. So act as to treat humanity, whether in thine own person or that of any other. In every case as an end with all, never as means only. Immanuel Kant is the giant of 18th century philosophy. Many would argue he was the greatest philosopher ever. In 1781, he published his Critique of Pure Reason. He followed this with two further critiques, on practical reason and judgment. He also wrote on religion, politics, and psychology. Though all our knowledge begins with experience, it does not follow that it all arises out of experience. Kant did not even accept the empiricist's theory that all ideas arose out of experience.
Well, he agreed with the empiricists in that he thought that all our knowledge, all our substantive knowledge about the world must ultimately relate to experience, which is a basic empiricist theme. And he was sure that they were right about that. He was as reluctant as they were to countenance the idea of conclusions about things that utterly transcended our experience. For example, he had no patience at all with attempts to prove the existence of a transcendent God, or with speculations about an afterlife, for example, what might happen to us after our deaths. When these were understood as attempts to come again at substantive knowledge, I mean, he didn't feel that we could have knowledge about these things at all. He was sympathetic to attempts to think in those terms and to speculate about those things, but he was of a mind with the empiricists in denying that we could know anything about those realities beyond our experience. So in that sense, he was very much in line with them, as against the rationalists. He agreed that all our knowledge must ultimately relate to experience and be grounded in experience. But he didn't think that it was all simply read off from experience. He thought that when we derived knowledge of the world through the deliverances of experience, it was because we ourselves were appropriately receptive to what was out there. And being appropriately receptive meant having certain faculties in terms of which we interpreted what was out there, certain faculties that enabled us to make sense of what was out there. And an analogy that is often used in this connection, it's not Kant's own analogy, but it's quite a useful analogy, is that it's as if we were operating with a pair of spectacles, epistemological spectacles, through which we interpret what the world throws at us, as it were. But these spectacles are unlike ordinary spectacles in that we can never take them off. I mean, everything that we know through this basic framework. They provide a kind of structure for what we know, a framework, as I say, through which we interpret things. That is where the element of idealism lies, because we ourselves are making a contribution to the shape of our experiences. The reason why Kant wanted to call it transcendental idealism, saw it as a special kind of idealism, was that we could never take our spectacles off. There was no such thing as taking our specs off and stepping back and looking at this process as it was in itself. We were always constrained to see things through this basic framework. And that's why he felt that it was appropriate to distance himself, for example, from Berkeley, whose view was also obviously an idealist view, but who felt that the idealistic processes that were giving us knowledge were themselves things that we could reflect on and come to know about.
Kant later attempted to justify the various principles according to which objective experience must be organized. In the section of the Critique of Pure Reason called the Dialectic, Kant explores his own theory of ideas, which are pure concepts of reason. Because we have reason, we naturally have these ideas. Kant also dealt with ethics and morals. Nothing in the world, indeed nothing even beyond the world, can possibly be conceived which can be called good without qualification, except a good will.
What Kant means by a good will is a will that's exercised in complete accord with its own freedom. That's to say, a will that is, in a popular phrase that's often used in this connection, a will that's a law unto itself. It's following its own principles, its own rules, its own laws. And those laws, Kant believes, he has all sorts of interesting arguments to substantiate this belief, those laws are the laws of morality. A good will is a will that acts on principle, purely for the sake of principle, doing what it does simply because that's the right and proper thing to do, that's the law-governed thing to do, and doing that in turn simply because it's acting in accord with its own laws, that is to say, it's acting in a way that's completely autonomous and free. So a good will is a will that's, if you like, obeying the laws of its own freedom. And that has important resonances for Kant, because that in turn is a will that is completely moral in its determinations, in its behaviour, in the behaviour that it causes.
In the Critique of Judgment, Kant explores how our aesthetic judgments depend upon the interplay of imagination and understanding. Kant lived for 80 years, but never married. During that time, he never strayed far from his native Königsberg, but his philosophy was to influence the whole world.
In modern philosophy, Kant's influence is second only to that of Descartes. So the defining moment of the beginning of modern philosophy is Descartes' Meditations, then the defining moment of later modern philosophy is Kant's Critique of Pure Reason. Mm-hmm. And Kant's influence is, in the 19th century, he spawns a whole idealistic, romantic movement in philosophy, unintentionally. In the 20th century, he's very influential in ethics, but also in political theory.
I mean, he's had an absolutely immense influence in general, and specifically on subsequent philosophers. His general influence has to do with the various Enlightenment ideals that he championed. He's a major figure in the Enlightenment, and we all know what kind of an influence that in turn had. He helped to put reason back on the map. He was able to champion reason and to give a compelling account of how much reason is able to achieve, how much human beings are able to achieve through the use of reason, through being purely rational, which is obviously a very important Enlightenment theme. And in particular, in his views about moral philosophy, he was able to give, again, a very compelling account of how far we're able to get in distinguishing between right and wrong simply by using our own natural, rational resources without having to appeal to authority, and in particular without having to appeal to the authority of religion. So that's a huge Enlightenment impact that he's had. But also specifically on philosophers, I mean, there's virtually no philosophy that has come since, in the 200 years since Kant died, that has not in some way been influenced by Kant. Very few people nowadays are straightforward Kantians. It's not that kind of influence. And people that see things in a very non-Kantian way still recognise the force of his arguments and the strength of his position, and see it as something that they have to respond to. So he's pretty much shaped the whole nature of subsequent philosophical discussion, set the parameters, determined what it is that people feel that they have to discuss, what the main issues are, what the main questions are that need to be addressed.
As the 19th century dawned and the Industrial Revolution changed the nature of society forever, philosophical thinking would begin to take a new turn. established beliefs would be challenged. As science advanced during the 18th and 19th centuries, the Industrial Revolution changed the way people worked and organized their lives. It also changed the way they looked at the world. A new generation of philosophers soon began to challenge Kant's theories. Whilst they accepted the idealism, they were dissatisfied with the limits he put on understanding and reason, and so sought to transform his idealism. What is rational is actual, and what is actual is rational. Georg Wilhelm Friedrich Hegel was born in Stuttgart in 1770 and studied at the University of Tübingen. Much of his writing is complicated and is difficult both to understand and to expound. He published his Encyclopedia of the Philosophical Sciences in 1817, and further expanded editions followed in 1827 and 1830. The Encyclopedia is a hugely ambitious work. Its aim is to take in the whole of reality, history, and knowledge in a systematic form.
Well, the Encyclopedia, published in 1830, the third edition, comes in three parts, and then three books. First called The Logic, and then A Philosophy of Nature, and A Philosophy of Mind or Spirit. And the idea all along, I think, is to develop a system of a way of thinking that will resolve problems in the natural world, in the way science treats the world, and in the human world, politically and ethically and so on, by using the categories that he's set out in The Logic.
There is much in the Encyclopedia that is influenced by Aristotle. Hegel was both a rationalist and a romantic. He had a keen sense of how the past affects the present. He claimed to have produced a complete map of all possible knowledge and reality. Hegel saw medieval Christianity as a prime example of what he called the unhappy consciousness. Judaism emphasized the separation between man and God. Christianity sought to unite man and God through the incarnation. Yet there is still a gap between the changing nature of the world and the unchanging nature of God.
He wants to integrate religion within philosophy. And the way he does it is to argue that basically the insights of religion are the same as the insights of philosophy, but just expressed or understood in religious terms. So he characterizes it as picture thinking, or thinking in terms of images or representations. So religion will talk about God, and will talk about the incarnation, will talk about creation and so on. And he thinks they're all legitimate ways of thinking about the world in a pictorial or story form. And philosophy is able to recast those ideas in more philosophical forms. So, for example, religion talks about the incarnation, or religion talks about creation as God creating the world. Well, what does that mean philosophically? Well, it means that there's a sort of rational structure inherent in things. And when we talk about God creating the world, we just mean, in sort of Einstein phrase, God doesn't play dice. Well, what does that mean? Well, we just mean that the world has a rational order. It's no accident, in some sense, that things, broadly speaking, are as they are. We can understand why things have to be a certain way. And that relates to the religious idea of God and God's creation and so on. So Hegel hoped that he could satisfy or give a place for religion in that way within a philosophical framework.
Hegel goes on to deal with reason and what he calls spirit, while contrasting the ancient world with the modern world.
What he means by spirit is a particular way in which consciousness, or conscious of a people or a community or a period, is then at home in the world. So he talks, for example, about the Greeks as ever-present spirit. And the reason he talks about the Greeks there is that he has a picture of the Greeks as having this integrated view of the world, at home in the world, such that they didn't seem to suffer from the various problems and tensions of the modern world. So spirit, what he calls spirit, was realized in some sense with the Greeks, was apparent in the Greeks, because they had this kind of unity with the world. Hegel's view is that for a variety of reasons, that at-homeness, that spirit in that period was lost. And that's really because he tends to treat the Greeks as a kind of childhood of human consciousness. So much like a child has a certain kind of happy relationship to the world, again, supposedly, before all the anxieties of adolescence set in. So the Greeks had a sort of simple, straightforward, but rather naive view of the world. They saw it as rational. They saw themselves as integrated within their communities and so on. We don't have that anymore. Ours is a more anxious time. We have all these tensions. We're not so convinced that the world is a hospitable and place at which we can be at home. But then he hoped that spirit, as it were, would return. This kind of integrated picture would return when these problems of modern consciousness could be resolved.
In Philosophy of Right, Hegel deals with social ethics and the state. His claim that the rational is the actual has led critics to claim that he wrote the book as an apology for the authoritarian Prussian state under which he lived, and that as a result, he should be seen as an influence on Nazism.
It's not clear, again, it's not obvious that Hegel was a reactionary figure, but in historical terms. But I think also you can think of the question philosophically. I mean, again, Hegel, as usual, is trying to strike a balance. So he does want, as I say, the individual to feel integrated within the state. It's not that he wants to get rid of any notions of individuality. But obviously that means that it can seem as if he nonetheless, because he wants to integrate the individual, he wants to still place some limits on the ways in which the individual can criticise the state or step outside the state. Now, even here, it's not clear that Hegel's saying the individual should always obey the state or should always feel at home with the state, should always accept the decisions the state should make. Because, again, he draws a contrast between the rational state, the state where there are proper mechanisms for dealing with individual interests and balancing them off against each other, and the non-rational state. So he does talk about figures in history, such as Socrates and Christ and so on, who were in a sense rebelling against the state of their time. And he sees that as perfectly legitimate because they're not living within the rational state. So it's only if the political conditions are right, as it were, that Hegel thinks the individual should by and large go along with the decisions the state are making.
No philosopher since Hegel has laid claim to the same kind of comprehensiveness and universality of thought.
Up until maybe 20 years ago or so, Hegel was a very marginal figure. People tended to read, study up to Kant, and then they would sort of leap from Kant to Frege or something of that sort, and Hegel would be just this sort of dark period where it all became obscure and difficult and bizarre, and nobody thought it should be taken particularly seriously. And it's more like as if somebody, you know, read Plato without reading Aristotle. If you read Kant and then don't bother to read Hegel, you're missing out on a whole range of important developments. And not just Hegel, other post-Kantian idealists like Schelling and Fichte as well. You're missing out on a whole range of developments that can appear very obscure and difficult and peculiar when you first look at them, but actually tap into rather deep and interesting issues that we're only now, I think, within the analytic tradition beginning to rediscover. Patients. So religion will talk about God, and we'll talk about the incarnation, we'll talk about creation and so on. And he thinks they're all legitimate ways of thinking about the world in a pictorial or story form. And philosophy is able to recast those ideas in more philosophical forms. So for example, religion talks about the incarnation, or religion talks about creation as God creating the world. Well, what does that mean philosophically? Well, it means that there's a sort of rational structure inherent in things. And when we talk about God creating the world, we just mean, in sort of Einstein phrase, God doesn't play dice. Well, what does that mean? Well, we just mean that the world has a rational order. It's no accident, in some sense, that things, broadly speaking, are as they are. We can understand why things have to be a certain way. And that relates to the religious idea of God and God's creation and so on. So Hegel hoped that he could satisfy or give a place for religion in that way within a philosophical framework.
Hegel goes on to deal with reason and what he calls spirit, while contrasting the ancient world with the modern world.
What he means by spirit is a particular way in which consciousness, or conscious of a people or a community or period, is then at home in the world. So he talks, for example, about the Greeks as ever-present spirit. And the reason he talks about the Greeks there is that he has a picture of the Greeks as having this integrated view of the world, at home in the world, such that they didn't seem to suffer from the various problems and tensions of the modern world. So spirit, what he calls spirit, was realized in some sense with the Greeks, was apparent in the Greeks, because they had this kind of unity with the world. Hegel's view is that for a variety of reasons, that at-homeness, that spirit in that period was lost. And that's really because he tends to treat the Greeks as a kind of childhood of human consciousness. So much like a child has a certain kind of happy relationship to the world, again, supposedly, before all the anxieties of adolescence set in. So the Greeks had a sort of simple, straightforward, but rather naive view of the world. They saw it as rational. They saw themselves as integrated within their communities and so on. We don't have that anymore. Ours is a more anxious time. We have all these tensions. We're not so convinced that the world is a hospitable and place at which we can be at home. But then he hoped that spirit, as it were, would return. This kind of integrated picture would return.
So that's a huge enlightenment impact that he's had. But also specifically on philosophers, I mean, there's virtually no philosophy that has come since, in the 200 years since Kant died, that has not in some way been influenced by Kant. Very few people nowadays are straightforward Kantians. It's not that kind of influence. And people that see things in a very non-Kantian way still recognise the force of his arguments and the strength of his position, and see it as something that they have to respond to. So he's pretty much shaped the whole nature of subsequent philosophical discussion, set the parameters, determined what it is that people feel that they have to discuss, what the main issues are, what the main questions are that need to be addressed.
As the 19th century dawned and the Industrial Revolution changed the nature of society forever, philosophical thinking would begin to take a new turn. Established beliefs would be challenged. As science advanced during the 18th and 19th centuries, the Industrial Revolution changed the way people worked and organized their lives. It also changed the way they looked at the world.
Thank you.
A new generation of philosophers soon began to challenge Kant's theories. Whilst they accepted the idealism, they were dissatisfied with the limits he put on understanding and reason, and so sought to transform his idealism. What is rational is actual, and what is actual is rational. Georg Wilhelm Friedrich Hegel was born in Stuttgart in 1770 and studied at the University of Tübingen. Much of his writing is complicated and is difficult both to
able to give again a very compelling account of how far we're able to get in distinguishing between right and wrong simply by using our own natural, rational resources without having to appeal to authority, and in particular without having to appeal to the authority of religion. So that's a huge enlightenment impact that he's had. But also specifically on philosophers, I mean, there's virtually no philosophy that has come since, in the 200 years since Kant died, that has not in some way been influenced by Kant. Very few people nowadays are straightforward Kantians. It's not that kind of influence. And people that see things in a very non-Kantian way still recognise the force of his arguments and the strength of his position and see it as something that they have to respond to. So he's pretty much shaped the whole nature of subsequent philosophical discussion, set the parameters, determined what it is that people feel that they have to discuss, what the main issues are, what the main questions are that need to be addressed.
As the 19th century dawned and the Industrial Revolution changed the nature of society forever, philosophical thinking would begin to take a new turn. Established beliefs would be challenged. As science advanced during the 18th and 19th centuries, the Industrial Revolution changed the way people worked and organized their lives. It also changed the way they looked at the world. A new generation of philosophers soon began to challenge Kant's theories. Whilst they accepted the idealism, they were dissatisfied with the limits he put on understanding and reason, and so sought to transform his idealism.
Necessarily hypocrites, because they have to disguise to themselves their unbelief. And he doesn't go as far as to deny that God exists, but through the mouth of various characters, he undermines belief in a first cause, in God as a substance, in the soul as a unity, and in immortality of the soul.
Hume concludes that in order for us to have any knowledge of a supreme being, is to witness an action that transgresses the laws of nature, as it is only through the world that God, as an infinite being, can express his nature and make himself felt. So God makes his presence known through miracles. Hume claimed that, like God and the self, we cannot observe causal connection.
For Hume, causality is just a succession of ideas, a contiguity of ideas, which are then linked together by the mind. And you can't actually find the necessity in nature. It's something that the mind adds in on top.
This holds true even with things that seem certain, like night following day. Day is not the cause of night. Night is brought on by the rotation of the Earth on its axis as it travels around the Sun. We cannot observe this rotation, so how can we be completely sure that night will follow day? Can we get beyond conjunction of events to actually observing their causes? Can we distinguish between events that are causally connected to those that are not? If we cannot, how can we make any general statements about the world? Where does this leave science?
He's not attacking science. As I said, he thinks of himself as a Newton of the mind. It's just that science and the connections in science have to be explained psychologically instead of in terms of logical and philosophical relations.
Hume had an answer to this seemingly bleak scenario. Although he advises we should hold our opinions with a healthy dose of skepticism, Hume was realistic about what drives human beings and the role played by the emotions. If we did try to live our lives querying everything we saw and stubbornly refusing to go about our daily lives because we do not know anything for certain, we would all curl up and die. It is better to be proved wrong sometimes in our assumptions than to abstain from doing anything at all. So act as to treat humanity, whether in thine own person or that of any other. He claimed to have produced a complete map of all possible knowledge and reality. Hegel saw medieval Christianity as a prime example of what he called the unhappy consciousness. Judaism emphasized the separation between man and God. Christianity sought to unite man and God through the incarnation. Yet there is still a gap between the changing nature of the world and the unchanging nature of God.
He wants to integrate religion within philosophy. And the way he does it is to argue that basically the insights of religion are the same as the insights of philosophy, but just expressed or understood in religious terms. So he just characterizes it as picture thinking, or thinking in terms of images or representations. So religion will talk about God, and will talk about the incarnation, will talk about creation and so on. And he thinks they're all legitimate ways of thinking about the world in a pictorial or story form. And philosophy is able to recast those ideas in more philosophical forms. So for example, religion talks about the incarnation, or religion talks about creation as God creating the world. Well, what does that mean philosophically? Well, it means that there's a sort of rational structure inherent in things. And when we talk about God creating the world, we just mean, in sort of Einstein phrase, God doesn't play dice. Well, what does that mean? Well, we just mean that the world has a rational order. It's no accident, in some sense, that things, broadly speaking, are as they are. We can understand why things have to be a certain way. And that relates to the religious idea of God and God's creation and so on. So Hegel hoped that he could satisfy or give a place for religion in that way within a philosophical framework.
Hegel goes on to deal with reason and what he calls spirit, while contrasting the ancient world with the modern world.
What he means by spirit is a particular way in which consciousness, or consciousness of a people or a community or period, is then at home in the world. So he talks, for example, about the Greeks as ever-present spirit. And the reason he talks about the Greeks there is that he has a picture of the Greeks as having this integrated view of the world, at home in the world, such that they didn't seem to suffer from the various problems and tensions of the modern world. So spirit, what he calls spirit, was realized in some sense with the Greeks, was apparent in the Greeks, because they had this kind of unity with the world. Hegel's view is that for a variety of reasons, that at-homeness, that spirit in that period was lost.
Beck's the present. He claimed to have produced a complete map of all possible knowledge and reality. Hegel saw medieval Christianity as a prime example of what he called the unhappy consciousness. Judaism emphasized the separation between man and God. Christianity sought to unite man and God through the incarnation. Yet there is still a gap between the changing nature of the world and the unchanging nature of God.
He wants to integrate religion within philosophy. And the way he does it is to argue that basically the insights of religion are the same as the insights of philosophy, but just expressed or understood in religious terms. So he characterizes it as picture thinking, or thinking in terms of images or representations. So religion will talk about God, and will talk about the incarnation, will talk about creation and so on. And he thinks they're all legitimate ways of thinking about the world in a pictorial or story form. And philosophy is able to recast those ideas in more philosophical forms. So for example, religion talks about the incarnation, or religion talks about creation as God creating the world. Well, what does that mean philosophically? Well, it means that there's a sort of rational structure inherent in things. And when we talk about God creating the world, we just mean, in sort of Einstein phrase, God doesn't play dice. Well, what does that mean? Well, we just mean that the world has a rational order. It's no accident, in some sense, that things, broadly speaking, are as they are. We can understand why things have to be a certain way. And that relates to the religious idea of God and God's creation and so on. So Hegel hoped that he could satisfy or give a place for religion in that way within a philosophical framework.
Hegel goes on to deal with reason and what he calls spirit, while contrasting the ancient world with the modern world.
What he means by spirit is a particular way in which consciousness, or consciousness of a people or a community or period, is then at home in the world. So he talks, for example, about the Greeks as ever-present spirit. And the reason he talks about the Greeks there is that he has a picture of the Greeks as having this integrated view of the world, at home in the world, such that they didn't seem to suffer from the various problems and tensions of the modern world. So spirit, what he calls spirit, was realized in some sense with the Greeks, was apparent in the Greeks, because they had this kind of unity with the world. Hegel's view is that for a variety of reasons, that at-homeness, that spirit and that period was lost.